Work with me.
A little while.
Work with me.
Galatians chapter 5. Beginning at verse number 1. From the New International Version of the Bible, you will find these words. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Verse number 7. You were running a good race. Who cut in on you to keep you from obeying the truth? That kind of persuasion does not come from the one who calls you. A little yeast works through the whole batch of dough. Verse number 10, I am confident in the Lord that you will take no other view. The one who is throwing you into confusion, whoever that may be, will have to pay the penalty. Galatians, let me just read that first verse one more time. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. For the time that is ours to share, I would like to preach. Might not do any hooping, but just talk to you for a little while. From the subject, standing firm in the faith. Standing firm in the faith. My brothers and my sisters, as we look at our text for today, we find ourselves in the book of Galatians. This particular letter was written by the Apostle Paul to the churches at Galatia to explain to them several tenets of our faith. One of the things that we look at when we look at this book is, what does it mean to be saved? Throughout our lives in the church, we use the term, I'm saved. We sing about I'm saved. You know, we have those songs, I'm saved, I'm saved, I'm saved, I'm saved, I'm saved through the storms of life. My soul keeps singing, I'm saved, I'm saved. But what do you mean? You're saved. What are you saved from? And what are you saved? To understand what it means to be saved, what salvation means. By its definition, salvation means deliverance. Being delivered, number one, from the power and the penalty of sin. When we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and personal Savior, we are delivered from the power of sin. Which means that if we choose, sin no longer has a yoke on our lives. We are saved from the power of sin, and we are saved from the penalty of sin. For the Bible says that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. But when you say you are saved, what do you really mean? Because can I mess with a few folks' theology for a few minutes? All right. Because not only are we saved from sin, but we are saved from the of Judaism. In other words, we are delivered from the law. As we look at Paul's dissertation here in the book of Galatians, there is a larger conversation that takes place. And that is, what is the relationship between one's faith and one's works? Now, we know in the church, we have rules and regulations. If you were to ever join this church or any church like this church, we're going to ask you one question. And it says, are you willing to abide by the rules and the regulations of the church? The rules and the regulations. When we look at this text, Paul helps us to understand the relationship between one's faith and between one's works. There are many who think that Paul and James have a disagreement when it comes to one's faith and one's works. Because Paul, being the apostle to the Gentiles, preached that faith, our salvation, is based on faith in Jesus Christ alone. It is not based on one's heritage. It is not based on one's circumcision. It is not based on one's keeping of the law. But salvation is based on our faith in Jesus Christ. But yet James says that faith without works is dead. When we look at this thing from the outside, it would seem as though Paul and James had a little disagreement. But can I attempt, if you will, to make it plain? Because there is literally no disagreement between Paul and James. Because it is impossible to be saved by your works alone. You cannot be saved by your works. There are not enough Sunday school lessons that you can go to. There are not enough church services that you can attend. There are not enough good deeds that you can do to ever earn salvation. Salvation is a gift from God through His Son, Christ Jesus. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on Him should not perish, but have an everlasting life. Church, I'm so glad that salvation is from our belief in Jesus Christ alone. But now once you get saved, then if you say that you're saved, not because you want to prove you're saved, but if you are saved, if you do believe, then your actions should follow what you believe. I wonder if I can witness somebody. I believe it was Barry White, the late Barry White, that said, practice. And so that's what James is saying. James is saying that if you have faith, then you got to back your faith up with what you do. But Paul says that in order to believe, in order to be saved, you must only believe. And that is a clear distinction for us as we look at this text. Because when we look at the fifth chapter in the book of Galatians, Paul's tone turns into a tone really of, I done told you once. I done told you twice. And don't make me say it a third time. Because what he's saying is to the churches at Galatia is that you were running a good race. You were recipients of the grace that was offered to you through your belief in Jesus Christ. You were running a good race, but somewhere down the road, somebody told you that you really were not a believer because you were not circumcised. Can I kind of make it plain here? Because if we're not careful, people will will try to categorize the level of our salvation based on what you do and what you don't do. You don't go to church every Sunday, you ain't saved like I am. You don't wear your dresses all the way down to your ankles, you ain't saved like I am. You wear lipstick and makeup and earrings, you ain't saved like I'm saved. And can I be honest with us all today? Somebody might say, what does it matter? Because when we look at the gospel of Jesus Christ, it is a gospel that is meant to be spread. But how can you spread the gospel when you're trying to box it in to what you think? So, if I go back and hit verse number one, it says that salvation means deliverance. Deliverance means freedom. And it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Therefore, stand firm. And do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Standing firm in the faith. When we look at that term stand, it indicates a sense or a position or a posture, if you will. If you think about the various postures that we have that we can do with our human body, there is nothing that no greater indicates or signifies assurance than standing. You can lay down. You can sit down. But when you stand up, that indicates that you are sure of a certain thing. What Paul says is that when we look at the various postures of our faith, he says, I have an accusation. I have an issue. And the issue is you are being run over. But he says you need to stand firm in the faith. Stand firm in the faith. Because he understood that there were those forces that were coming in to get them to bend over, to roll over, and to give up the assurance had in the salvation they had already experienced. Let me see if I can say it this way. On my job, on my 8 to whenever, I don't have an 8 to 5, I have a 8 to when I get through. But on my job, I do something called process management. Meaning I look at processes and then I try to look at where the issues are in a process and how we can make issues or how we can make processes better. And so to do that, we have what we call conditional statements. If and then. If this is true, then that will happen. If you do this, then that will happen. If then. What Paul is saying is that if you stand firm in the faith, then you will no longer be burdened by the yoke of slavery. In other words, what Paul says is that this is more than just an issue of theology. It is more than just an issue of what you believe or what church you belong to. But what he's saying is that this, in essence, is an issue of life and death. I know that Kanye West said that slavery was a choice. But I submit to us today that when we look at this text, we look at our life in Christ and being burdened by the yoke of slavery, there is no choice. What does it mean to be saved? In John chapter 8, verse number 36, he says, "He whom the Son sets free is free indeed." And when we begin to put all of these pieces together, Paul says to the Galatian church, number one, you are free from the burden of sin. That sin no longer has a place in your life. Number two, you are free from the spirit of legalism. Because although there was a covenant that existed in the Old Testament, and that covenant was the covenant of circumcision, that when Jesus came onto the face of the earth, he established a new covenant. And that new covenant was the covenant of grace. And I believe today that there is somebody here that knows about that thing called grace. Because grace is the unmerited favor of God. Grace says that there are some things that I did not earn, but God hooked me up. And I wonder, is there anybody here that knows about the hookup? In a natural sense, whenever somebody gives you a little extra, when somebody gives you a little tip, we call that the hookup. And so what happens is, when Jesus came onto the earth, he left a new covenant, and that covenant was the covenant of grace. That covenant said that although you might not have been Jewish by your birthright, that covenant says that although you might not have dotted every I across every T, that covenant says that if you believe on Jesus, then you shall be saved. And he whom the Son sets free is free indeed. And I wonder, is there anybody here that can say, I'm so glad that salvation isn't based on a series of do's and don'ts? Because if salvation were based on do's and don'ts, we would have missed the mark. But God stepped in and offered us grace. Grace is so amazing that the hymn writer said it was amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. And what is it? Yeah.
And today, standing firm in the faith, if there should be anyone here that does not have a personal relationship with a personal God, we invite you to come. Whoever you are, wherever you are, wherever you may be on the scale of life, this invitation is extended to you. Whosoever will, let them come. Come just as you are. Today, if you are here and you do not have a church that you call home, and you desire to unite or reunite with this Antioch United American People Baptist Church, we invite you to come. Could there be one? This is your day. This is your hour to make a decision for Jesus.
Sing along with the choir.